Greetings in the name of the Most High. Welcome back to the Zeph Report. I wonder if I can get my... where is it? Okay, since I don't know which one this is. Okay, well, thank you very much. Okay. So I'm working on this track here, and this has a real, something much different. Sun's coming up. Playback on some kind of lousy speakers, but it's a really trippy. Now it hadn't been mixed yet, we're just tracking it now. And but it features me playing this guitar. I'm trying to get you this. That sound right there. Believe it or not, oh, it's become like a pad. There's my bass. That's the phage on guitar, and that sounds pretty awesome. So I'm just waiting to get his end back from him, and then, this is just a off-the-laptop version here, and I took it in the studio last night, and I broke it out into 32, I have 32 analog channels of analog summing, so it's, when I broke it out into there, it was like the whole track just enveloped me. It almost became 3D. So now I know when we mix, which will maybe be starting today, I'm hoping to get more like a 3D feeling out of a 2D, you know, front, back, left to right, and make it much more like an experience. It goes on a while. It's like an 8-minute track. And working title is Sense Offense. And all I can tell you is it just was really a fun thing to work on. And it just, it's funny that right after that, an Atticus Ross track came out from Broken City soundtrack. And in a way, it just sounds like the same quality. And it's like, well, wait a second. I haven't mixed it yet. Nothing wrong with that Broken City soundtrack was not a good movie, but it's a fantastic record from the standpoint of just super cool composition and just amazing work. And I like it when my tracks hold parity with that, when they're about like on the same level. It shows that there's been progress. But what I want to do with it, you know, level aside, you know, volume, it's really, to me, not about volume so much. It's about more like depth. Obviously, pleasing to the ear's warmth so that you're brought right into it. But I want you to hear things behind your head, in front of you, to the side. So when you go into this world, you're really, you know, and then each thing that comes up, you know, as the drums, certain drums fade out, then other ones come in, and then guitars kind of are in, and then they fade out, then a bass comes up. And so those little surprises happen during the progress of the track. You're just already going with it, you know? So it's taking you places rather than you going, wow, this is good, or I like this. Instead of that, what I'd like to create is this, you know, from the post-production end, is basically this thing like, I really am, you know, I'm in a virtual reality. I'm somewhere, I'm going somewhere, something is happening to me. And I would love to, you know, I haven't approached my collaborator with this, but I'd like to do a whole record, you know, like an hour of this one journey, you know, this one sonic journey. Now, I have a word about tuning, and this is going to be disappointing for people. We talked about sacred music, and then I said all music is sacred, all sound is sacred. It's just in this fallen state, in this one configuration we happen to be in, of all the trillions of configurations, the profane rules the day. But music itself, aside from us or anyone hearing it, just on its own, is sacred. Would you agree? Trish, you agree? Music is sacred. You know, just take us out of the equation for a minute and just have a note, you know, C3 or something. It's, or, you know, an A3. You can't find anything wrong with it. It's pure. Yeah. It's sacred. It's that when we touch things, we have this good and evil in us. We have this fallen condition. And we then, you know, make it profane, or usually profane means materialistic, where music is a language of the spirit, not of the material world. Oh, you can have love songs about how you're, you know, lusting after your childhood sweetheart and whatnot, and I suppose there is that, you know, songs to be played in the convertible on the way to the beach while you're thinking about, you know, all you want to do is get next to some gal that you knew in college, and there she is at the beach, and it's all exciting, it's a great summer, and then the summer's over, and now it's bummer time, and you ain't with her, and gee, oh, that's really sad. go ahead. I mean, the Eagles did that. You know, they certainly know what commercial music is. But the idea of commerce and music doesn't, to me, have any correlation whatsoever. The fact that, you know, I looked at the list for the Grammys and all, you know, it's like, yeah, the same old Taylor Swift up for every award and blah, blah, blah. You know, it's boring as can be. And when you tune into the music, it's like you find the same mastering engineers on every song. And the whole Grammy, it means he's like on 30 songs or something, you know. And so they all have the same sound. And it's like, great, you know, just homogenize it, why don't you? But, you know, but that's what I mean. They've made it into something that, because music is so powerful, it can be made into a commercial thing. But it of itself is free. No, I'm not here to rag on the Grammys. I'm making a point. I don't care about the Grammys. I mean, they're free to give themselves awards in their little club all they want. They do it all year long. They don't just have the Grammys. They have these awards going all year long with the best this and the best that. They have the best. I'm glad to see they had some roots in there. They had American roots music, but they also had some reggae roots music that gets a Grammy, but it's the same old artists that were there last year and were there the year before and the year before. So it's like, you'd mean to tell me out of the whole world, this is it? These are all the artists, these same names over and over again? And they have a lot of categories. I don't even know why I take the Hollywood Reporter, but of course they publish what you miss out on out there is you don't have the inside, you know, the trade paper. They publish all the nominations and it's very extensive. But then it's the same old, you know, same old soup just warmed over. And, you know, so, but see, it's not my fight. You know, I'm not here to fight for equality of the Grammys, of letting other people have a chance besides those in the club. They don't do that in Hollywood ever. That's all nepotism. They do the same thing in the movies, in the movie business. They do the same thing in sports. You know, it's just all, run by a very select small group of people. In their own fiefdom, in their own little dictatorship, and everybody around Hollywood, you know, kisses their ass trying to catch a break to get in there. And I think there's nothing I can do about it. It's not my fight. Like I say, I'm not knocking on their door. I can appreciate a lot of the music that has been commercial. Like right now, I was sort of marveling over how simple Bob Dylan songs are to play on guitar because I was learning and like on knocking on Heaven's Door just because I like that song a lot. But then I'm learning about how there's no bridge, there's no turnaround, there's no big chorus, you know, it's just like one chord difference in the chorus besides the verse. There's only two verses and one's repeated. And it's like, oh, wow, the best stuff is simple. So you can learn from, you know, Hollywood, from entertainment, you know, why stuff works. It's usually because it's really simple. And that's like this track we have now. It's very simple, kind of riffing on A and E, but it takes you somewhere, you know, and it would never work in a commercial format. This song is free. But it's not just a weapon, this one, you know, of spiritual warfare. It is, meaning if you're on the right side, you'll love it. It is a vehicle, a vessel that you get into and you go. And that's, well, you know, that remains to be seen. Let me not put that much pressure on myself. I was telling him it could be like an audiophile mix, you know, for people that like Daft Punk and some of these other great mixes. It could be something like that. You know, I'm not saying I love Daft Punk music, but the mixes are, Mick Gazowski's mixes are fantastic. But, and he may, you know, I didn't see his name. Funny, he won a bunch of Grammys in 2012, I think, for the, but he's, like a lot of these people, it's all compartmentalized, you know, that the mixer is usually in his own realm, like, say, you know, and he's mixing in the box, and then they, when he sends it off to the mastering people, they put it on tape, and then I don't think they do another mix down, but they have, they take the stems, you know, which would be the instruments, vocal, and percussion, and then they'll mix those down again and master it, so it's you know, and then they also have the option of the mix that he does, that he has a little bit of light limiting on it, with nothing on the master bus, for those of you who don't know audio engineering. And a lot of times they'll take that one and forget and put that off on the 2-inch tape and then bring that back in blown up and print it and then make your MP3s, which is an insult, and also lossless media as well. You know, it has to go back into the digital box. I mean, you know, there's no way to leave. You know, I'm so tempted. I really would like to. Like my brother and I, when we were young, we were music fanatics. I mean, I guess we've always been in music, you know. And we really, you know, we had the Stones and the Beatles. I mean, we were current in the mid-60s. Each of us got a Sony tape recorder for I think it was for Christmas. Way back when we were really young, we're almost too young to understand how it's like an adult thing. We both got one. We never asked for it, but it wasn't a toy. You know, toys didn't last long, but those recorders, and he immediately went and started archiving all the Beatles and all the, you know, and a whole bunch of stuff. And then I was making mixtapes as well back then when we were just kids. And so then you'd have this reel-to-reel tape, right? And depending on, so you go down to the local record store and you could always buy tape, blank tape, at the local record store. Now, how many of you remember that? So you go in and get the latest album, you know, 12-inch vinyl, right? Or a 45. And then you buy a, you know, blank tape, which is reel-to-reel, and then bring it home. Now, they had short play tape, which could go at a faster speed. If Rick would always, he would always record everything at the slowest speed. And, you know, the slower the speed of the tape, the less quality there is. And the faster the tape goes, you know, if it goes... Same thing with video, you know, but I mean, you want the tape to go faster. So basically, he wanted it to last like 4 hours. So if you put a reel-to-reel on, you know, and that's all we listen to, you know, and you listen to that reel-to-reel and listen with headphones, you know, and then eventually we had it going through a system that my parents had, and eventually we had our own stereos. I don't know how we ended up getting those, but you could... you could get it to go for four and a half hours. And I thought that was ridiculous, but he had everything in the world on there, like on one tape, you know, so he could just go and go and go. And mine were more like I would record at the faster speed and playback at the faster speed. But I was able to put, you know, like two or three albums on one tape and or mix up tracks and have just different tracks, you know what I mean, and record those off the phonograph, the turntable. And, you know, there was just something about the tape. And then, you know, cassettes came in and they weren't the same quality as reel-to-reel. Now, these were consumer reel-to-reels by Sony. And they never said tape recorder, it said tape quarter or something. You know, it was like it said quarter rather than recorder. And I always wondered about that, you know, why Sony would have that. Now, though, looking back on it, I mean, I love the convenience of like hearing a track, then Kelly's got a track she's working on, that I heard that this morning as well. And that's a really great traditional American kind of feel to it, nice emotion. And I told her, she wanted me to, you know, tell her what I thought. So it's like, yeah, it needs to be worked, or, you know, developed, but great song, great tune. And hopefully we'll be able to work on it. I'd like to. But anyway, regarding that, I'm sitting at the laptop in the living room, and I have my, I have like a studio here, and then I have this living room where I have the window view, and I have, you know, and there's no kids or anything here, so I leave it set up. I have a little laptop, which you know is psychedelic, and then I have these little bi-amped Genelec speakers. I forget them. All the model numbers I can't remember. But I'm a Genelec fan. I mean, if you want to know what is the mix of, what is, I like Genelec, and then we made a move to Genelec in the studio as well, the bigger ones, which are kind of a new design that they came up with. And it's helped me to get, it's not like you can just rock out in there to really loud speakers, which also damages your ears. It's more their precision, you know, so that, you know, you hear what's going on so you can fix it, you know, so you can improve it. So that's really helped. But that's after going through all the different speakers I've gone through, that's the one company I decided to go with. And out in the living room area, we have these little bi-amp speakers with little 4-inch woofers, but they sound unbelievable. I mean, they're just, and you carry them around. I carry them around, like if I go somewhere, I you know, not all the time, but I carry them around because they're heavy, they're metal, you know, very high quality. And they're serious professional monitors, but you can carry them around with you. And so I have it set up out there to like, I like to track, you know, guitar and bass and different things and synth and whatnot. And then you know, if I, once that's done and the inspirational part of it is done, then at that point I take it all into the studio to you know, start mixing, right? So I found that, you know, breaking up the process into being inspired when you're tracking, you know, coming up with piano parts or synth parts or, you know, drum parts or whatever. You can always add more later, but that initial inspiration, I think I'd rather be in an environment that's really conducive to that creativity. You know what I mean? It could be like a hotel room even. It could be, you know, it's rather than just being in this cave-like environment for, I just find that having windows and sky and sun and you know, a sense of reality, it just gives the spirit joy. And now that's when you want to create. That's when you get all these ideas. When you're in, you know, the dark studio environment with no windows and, you know, foam and whatnot all over the walls everywhere and, you know, the two hot tubes from all the hardware that's in there, and you know, it just has this, you know, this feel of sweat, and you know, like you're really working out, and a lot, you know, so it's that kind of work, you know, more that sort of heavy lifting work, but you know, it's how much more awesome is it to be somewhere else, like even in the RV, I've had that set up in the RV like that, where you're just in some remote place. And then, you know, you feel that inspiration to create something, and you get out of your head for a minute, you know. there is a set of drums in the studio, which obviously to play those, I've got to go back and actually, you know, put the headphones on and sit back there behind the kit and play the kit. And I thank God that's there, because you're going to get things from tracks from me and us that that feature the real deal. And like the last couple of tracks out, that's what I left things rough. I left them live, like we were playing, like the way we did as kids, you know. I didn't want to polish it up. I wanted to give you this pure analog, you know, a bass recorded through a bass cabinet, right? A guitar recorded through a Fender amp, you know, drums through analog preamps, you know, each having a separate channel. And then mix it all down, you know, to see what we get. And what we got was, you know, this, well, I have some issues now with the mix, playing it back now later. I mean, I'm still on the quest for the good mix, you know, I'm still not completely satisfied, but I'm more than I was. Like over the last couple of years, I'm more satisfied, but I'm still, I feel like I need to loosen up a little bit. You know, I need to, like, just, like, today, you're going to get, like this one, you're going to get a flow, you know. And the last couple was all about, it was all about deconstructing all the digital world and the computer, and it was all just about playing, you know. So if there was a gross mistake, I would edit it, you know, I would move the audio around if it wasn't on the right beat or whatever, but... You know, I'd leave some off, you know, because I wanted you to hear me play drums. I mean, I'm flawed. I mean, I'm not a metronome, you know. I mean, I played to a click, you know, so it's in time, but I'm not a machine, right? There's a time for a drum machine, you know, but not on a rock track where you have bass, guitar, and drums, which is that was the basic band that was my favorite band. It was just bass, guitar, and drums. Or if you like guitar, bass, and drums, or if you like drums, bass and guitar, or drums, guitar, and bass, whichever one you want to say first. But that was the magic for me. That was the roots. And, you know, I don't know why I'm mentioning that. I'm just, why I'm doing this talk about those things. But I like to bring you in every once in a while. So you feel, remember I was talking about going into a different dimension? The news is still bad, but I'm not in the same dimension as I was 2 days ago, am I? My heart is filled with hope and love, even though, you know, some people might not think so, but it is. That act of, you know, forgiving all this stuff, and it's tough for a guy like me because, you know, here's what I'm dealing with. I have to turn away. The sun is so bright, I got to turn away from it. Okay, it's a beautiful, bright morning in New Mexico. It's just utterly gorgeousity. My heart sings. And I want you to feel that. Ah. Right? Right? You need it too. Well, okay. So, you know, how did I jump soul tracks or dimensions? By forgiving everyone and everything. Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's basically what I say. You know, they can't, I've queried them, you know, folks, do you know what you're doing? Do you know, like in this gang stalking thing, the part you're playing, you know, I mean, I've really, do you know there's a secret other world there somewhere? You know, and we know what the secret other world is. The secret other world is not of this dimension. I mean, not of any of these dimensions here, not of this world at all. They have limited access to it, those that join the club, but it's still, when you add it all up, it gets boring for them because they only see so much that they're allowed to see. They don't get to see the whole enchilada. Because you see, if they did, they would be what? Disappointed. Yes, they would see the man behind the curtain and they would get upset. Yeah, I sold out everything for this? That's the answer you're giving me? And it's like, yeah, there is no answer. You want to go to outer space? Tough, you're not going to go. That's basically what they're told. You know, they come in, they go, ooh, ah, look at the candy store. Oh, wow, the average idiot out there doesn't know anything about this. And then they see the painted set, the Truman, that they're just on a set of yet another Truman Show where they are Truman. And then they're shown another infinite number of Truman shows that they're not even a part of, and they never will be. And then they get depressed. And then they start taking Prozac. And, you know, they start focusing on material things, which is what they actually sold it out for the material things. And I say, well, that's your bed. You know, enjoy it. I'm not going to judge you. I'm not going to get... I know you're going to do bad things to other people. And that's your nature. I understand that lions eat zebras. Yes, I do. But I'm not going to get all caught up in it and blame them for my troubles. No. I'm going to stay away from them if they want. If I'm a zebra and they're a lion, I'm going to, you know, Peter says it best. What is that, in 2 Peter or 1 Peter? Quick, quiz. You don't know your Bible? All right, I'll have to do it for you. Let's just get down to Peter, shall we? It's really hard for me to believe that Peter... what verse is that? Should I just look it up? Should I, you know... Okay. Okay, let's see if we can... I'm just going to try to cut to the chase here. It's 1 Peter 5:8. I knew it was 1 Peter. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Now, this is one of the greatest scriptures of all time. It goes hand in hand with Ephesians 6. So whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus here, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Yes? That's a beautiful set of scriptures right there, because it shows you your legal status, what God will do with you. And he's saying, yes, you suffer a little while in this life. You know, compared to eternity, it's but a little while. But look, you're established forever and ever, like it says in the book of Daniel. You're established like the stars in the heavens. The forever kingdom, he calls it in Daniel 7, that will not be overcome by anything the likes of the New World Order or anybody else. Once that forever kingdom is established, that's it. Ain't no going back then. So we know who wins this. Daniel is great inspiration for talking about that forever kingdom. But that's it. I mean, when I say, you know, I'm here with my eyes on the perimeter every day, that doesn't mean I can't kick back and have joy in a way, but there has to be this extra eye out, you know, for the enemy. Otherwise, you know what they do, you know, when you're kids, they always have these girls, if you're a guy, trying to, like, kind of lead you, tempt you over to the dark side. And the problem with most guys is they just stay there. You know, just like my grandpappy. And like it's okay because other people did it, so it's okay. And, you know, I mean, you know, that's two different paths. All I can say is, you know, you in the world, I've used this Zephyrport, this platform, to reach out to you people that were my friends. Well, now I don't think you think so, because you know, I'm like a traitor because I dared to live and to breathe, and so sorry, you know. But it had nothing to do with you. You may one day understand that. It's got nothing to do with you. I'm not a traitor to you. I am not your enemy. You're taught to believe stuff like that because you're taught wrong, and you believe wrong. And so you believe a lie on all the way into the grave. But it's not like I haven't given you years of my life as to reach out to you, to help you, because you want redemption. I could see it. You know, speaking of that, I saw an old classmate that had reached out to me on Facebook, but because of this is sad, you know, but I have to mention it. And he goes, wow, you've been on a really long journey. My God, you know, because it's been from dropping out of high school, which wasn't really my fault. I had to drop out of that school I was in, that elite school, because I was so messed up, you know. It's no fault of my own. I mean, I realize that now, but I mean, everyone was blaming me then. But that journey, so from this guy's perspective, it would have been from then, say 11th grade, all the way to 35 years later. And he wanted me to go to a school reunion. I said, you know, I told him I'm not going to any reunion because, you know, I wasn't part of it. And then it was some 40-year reunion because of a class of 72 or whatever. And I found a video of it online, and then I eventually came to learn, and I saw him in the video. And I'm like, oh, the guy looks good. He became, a doctor of sports medicine. But anyway, then I see that there was an obituary, and he had passed away in August of this year. So there never was a reunion. And I recalled an incident way back when. There was a party at his house, his parents' house, and he had a sister, I remember. And maybe it was a joint party. And there, I was gang-stalked. You know, I was basically set up for, I thought they were going to kill me or they're doing something to me. It was just this weird, messed up situation. And he was like leading this gambling, or he had something about the lambs, like they were gambling on all of us being lambs because we weren't in their club or whatever it was, in that spiritual difference, in that dark to light, light to dark fulcrum matrix. And he was adding up the number, like he was gambling on, you know, there were certain stats and percentages, and he was following all that. And I realized that it had something to do with me. And that's just totally evil, you know what I mean? So then I remembered why. So when he contacted me, I didn't realize that memory at the time had been gone. And, well, I ended up getting up and leaving the, there was all these people, there were people from my school and people from, you know, and it just all started getting weird. And they were not like people I used to know. They just were like predatory demons. So I, you know, humiliated. I got up and got out of there. And it was just a disaster of a night, and I felt terrible about it, and I wanted to kill myself because I thought I'm doing something wrong, obviously. You know, it's my fault. And, you know, I always felt bad about that particular night, but I couldn't hang around with people starting to talk about percentages and you know, odds, you know, and gambling on what someone like me would do or not do. I mean, I just found that to be so cynical. I just couldn't deal with it. And he was sort of the ringleader. It's like this kid who was this innocent kid. We played. We went to grade school together and high school together and prep school and pre-high school together, whatever, junior high. We all the way through these schools together. We went to each other's houses, celebrate each other's birthdays. You know, it was all like that. And then he's like heading up this, I don't even know what, and he's reporting on these percentages, and it's like, what percentage? You know, it's just, I can't even bring it to a clarity right now to where you could understand, but it that memory came up, and considering, you know, because it really tore me up that, you know, he had died, and I kept thinking, you know, I wonder if we'll ever meet again, you know, and I certainly, it can't be some reunion of something that was an utter abject failure for me. You know, there's no joy in that. But of course, I'm curious. I wish that circumstances weren't like that. I wish that we had all gone, you know, I wish that I had maintained contact, but I couldn't. So, you know, so I saw this video and, you know, this is like a 40-year anniversary or something, and I'm following them around and recognizing some faces from 43 years ago. Funny how we don't age. And then all of a sudden, you know, I realized I kind of cut him off on Facebook, you know, because of spiritual warfare, because I was triggered, but I didn't know why. And then finally, well, yesterday I knew why, because that I remembered that night. And I never dealt with that night. You know what I mean? It was like one of those things I just, out of sight, out of mind. And it came back. I had to deal with it yesterday, of what happened and his betrayal of me. And that's why it didn't. He says, wow, you've been on a long journey. Like he's working me. Like he's hustling me. You know, come on in. You know, I'm like, so it triggered me. You know, it's like, no, I'm not going there. You contact me after all this time, obviously spying on me. And, you know, you go, you've been on a long journey. It's like, dude, I would say to him, I know he's in the grave, but I would say, I haven't been on a long journey. I have simply tried to survive the best that I could given the circumstances. If you were in my shoes, you would have done the same thing. Oh, no, I would. No, yes, you would have done the same thing. Because, you see, the my shoes mean that you bounce off the mirror. You don't, you know, it's God makes different ones for different things. It's not this idea that anyone could be on, you know, on one side or the other. No, there's a destiny too. There's, you know, my destiny, the way the Lord had me was, he was just going to, I was either going to do it his way or he was going to just throw me in a grave. There was no, you know, that it was going to be the sort of the John the Baptist path or nothing at all. You know, even though all I wanted was to be liked and accepted and, you know, part of the club and part of the team and all that. But you know, the thing is that it's supernatural. There are those meant for that and those not. And the ones who are in that little club, which is really the big tent club, the majority, prey upon the lambs. And, you know, they can act like they don't, but they do. And, you know, God has, you know, protects his own. Anyway, that was a, you know, horrific thing. I mean, you know, this gang stalking thing, which was, that's what it really is. Being invited somewhere that everyone, like, you know, takes their mask off and it's all about you and they're coming at you. That's not normal, you know, and you're triggered, your fear, flight or fight syndrome kicks in and, you know, it's just terrible. So it's not like I didn't forgive him. I forgive him for that, you know. But when he contacted me in like 2012 on Facebook, you know, it wasn't like with a repentant heart, not a guy looking for redemption from the Lord, you know, no, and not a guy that's going to acknowledge what my path had been, because it's, I'm like, okay, I've been on a long journey. What has it been? What's your perception of that journey? Not someone that's tuning into me, but someone who's still trying to reel me in to something that is killing him. Still playing the freaking game, man. And now he's dead. Young, too, probably was like 59. Well, I think about my own mortality, and I think, well, if I died today, it'd be okay. It'd be fine. You know, I mean, I've done, you know, just means that the Lord bring me home. I know exactly where I'm going. And, you know, so it's win-win. I mean, it's I don't dread it. I mean, I feel, you know, I don't want to leave people behind. I want to try to leave them in as good a shape as I possibly can. But, you know, knowing I can't be here, you know, my daughter will outlive me, you know, and if she has kids with this guy she's with, then I'm, you know, right? I mean, it's sort of, you know, I've got to deal with that. Well, I still have, I've got a lot of things to do. I mean, I don't ever want to die. But the reason that when this Facebook contact happened, I also got the feeling that he was being put up to it by other people that were just, yeah, let's see if we, you know. And it's like, yeah, one for the team. And I'm like, you got the school ring? Be true to your school? Meaning, sell your souls to Satan, act like you didn't do anything, and then stay true to your school all the way into the grave, man? And be a blight on the earth and a blight on your children and a curse to your children. Vote for Obama by all means. You know, whatever. Or be in the world and have your favorite senator and whatever and have your school and have your whatever it was. This guy lived near UCLA. So have your UCLA experience, whatever. I don't understand that. You got one chance to live here. One. Not two. Not three, not an endless amount of time as my friend now passed on. Many of them have passed on. But it was clear to me from our contact in 2012 that he hadn't learned anything. He was just sitting there in criticism of my long journey. And isn't it now time, Don Quixote, for you to give that up? I kid you not, that was the attitude. It was like that, and then that triggered me into, okay, I'm not talking to this guy. And then that, finally, when I saw Obit, I saw him on a video walking around looking pretty healthy too. Not looking infirm, but walking around, you know, a healthy looking guy, looked a lot younger than everybody else there. Interacting with people and having a smile on his face, dead. Just like that. Same thing happened with the bass player I used to be in a band with, and I love this guy. And I saw him, and he'd been at it all this time. And I mean, what happened to us is he went back to prison because he did some things, and you know, he had problems with like heroin in prison. But he was, you know, he would tell me stories about prison that would just make your hair stand on end. It was just unbelievable. But anyway, you know, and I didn't judge him at all for that. I understood he was in a battle. But I found out that he played music once he got out of prison again. I don't think he never went back again, which is amazing. And he'd been writing songs ever since, and I heard them, they were quite good, and he hooked up with a recording studio in, I think, up in Vegas. And he'd been there recording song after song and, you know, just doubling down on it. He was a bass player and a vocalist and obviously the last part of his life was just all writing. He would write off the bass. He would compose on the bass and write song after song after song. Blues. And then he had a blues band, and they'd play in Vegas, you know, in the better blues clubs. Oh, he was good. So, I mean, he would be playing in the top blues clubs, singing blues, doing all that. So, yeah, that's what I loved about him. But, you know, the thing is, when I saw him, I saw 2013 Facebook. And I thought, I wonder why I had a guitar player that was in that band that told me that this guy was active, he was around, but he was mad at me, you know, anyway, because he said that I become a religious fanatic and I'm, you know, I can't be reached. So he blew me off and he didn't tell me about our partner there. The three of us were in a band. I said, well, those were the best days of my life back then. Though that was the real deal back then. That's when music was really happening too, you know, the whole music scene. That was like 1970, I want to say 4, 5, 6. So then I see that he had Reverb Nation account. I went over there and he, again, all I saw was 2013. Finally, I said, do I dare do this? And I type in the name and then Obit, you know. Sure enough, he died in 2014. This was someone I really cared about. And I don't know what his status was. I think he did love God. He was a really good guy, but he's, you know, he had that criminal thing, you know. And it looked to me like God had healed him of that. You know, like I say, he never went back. But I mean, it would have been great to have. But again, boom, there it goes. He's gone. You know, it's not my fault. I didn't think to look him up. It never occurred to me. It just suddenly occurred to me to look him up. Like the Lord was showing me. I can't look everything and everyone up I've ever known. You'd think that I would have. No, because I was, you know, I had to leave that band and leave, you know, I was trying to find out what happened before and what the gang stalking thing was all about and all this weird stuff that was happening and supernatural stuff. And so I, you know, it's bands and things like that couldn't stick because I had this other thing I had to do. So people that I knew, you know, I had to push away like they didn't exist. And then all of a sudden, now that the thing is settled, that we understand, I look back and I find many of them are dead. It's okay, because I mean, I'm all right with that. Why? Because I came into this world alone and I go out alone. Just like my ex-bandmate, who was a, you know, I was up against stiff drumming competition too. I had to earn my way into that band. Yeah, there's some really good drummers, but I succeeded. I always win the audition in drums. I never took drumming that seriously because I think it was just really easy for me, you know. And so when it came time to put it down to go on my journey to find out what happened, I could easily put the drums away and the bands away and all of it, and just try to conform. You know, I tried to look like I was in business and in LA, and I tried to look the part like I never had a problem in school. Like I was just all put together, and I was just as fragmented and damaged as one could be. But I had to find out what happened. I mean, what was this gang stuff? What was this, the thing where people change and they look like they're from another dimension, and they're the next day they're okay again? And were they really, were those the same people? And you know, all this very confusing, horrible stuff that was happening. And then, of course, the forced, being removed from being incarcerated and all that. You know, all that I didn't appreciate either, because it was being interrogated and being medicated. You know, I mean, medication, what for what? Being messed with every day, being lied to about the world, being lied to about friends, being told that, you know, you're living in a bubble that we have created, and we're never going to let you out of that bubble. And it's like, well, what is this? And then all of a sudden they're like, they don't know anything about it. So they have all this information, and then all of a sudden they clam up like they're two different people. Do you know what I mean? So this guy, you know, back to the other guy, you know, the classmate, I went to grade school, like I say, early grade school, you know, fourth grade, fifth grade, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, ninth grade, tenth, you know, all through all that time. And then seeing him on the video and then seeing the obit right after that, I was just lying in bed awake last night, you know, unable to sleep, because I kept thinking about what this meant, you know. And then I saw other people from that period of time. It's just a snapshot in time, you know. But I think what it is that, like I explained the other day, to survive, I had to, like, I couldn't be, like, cushy, you know what I mean? Families, I couldn't, you know, I was like, I was all alone. And this idea, this construct of friends, school, family, all of it became an abstraction. It had to be pushed away like it never happened. And I had to go like a blank slate onto the next thing. Another batch of friends, so-called. And they seemed like the earlier one. It didn't seem any more deep than that. So then I realized, oh, okay, I'm walking through this alone, and all these are just projections. Absolutely. So they could be put away and put to the side. And then I also regretted having to put my music career away, you know, to walk away from that, because the same thing started happening there, out of the blue. You know, and they you know, even by Christians who were famous musicians that said they were Christians. And they were the worst of all in terms of spiritual warfare against us. And I said, why are you doing that? What is this? You're no different than, you know, the Satan, the devil worshiper. Yeah, welcome to the NFL, buddy. That's the way it is. And this guy's not going to repent no matter what you say to him, because he's not there to repent. Yeah, but he's a big-time Christian. Oh. He ain't really no Christian, I see. He's just another. And this guy that died, and I look back on memories, it's like I don't have that many fond memories of with these people, with these children. You know, I think with them, you know, they have these memories. Then there was another guy that, you know, they caught him on video, and then another guy was saying to him, and this is a guy that's a very successful guy, I'm not going to mention anything about names or anyone, you know, protect their privacy, because I have respect, you know. But he was going around trying to confess his, like, you know, trying to unload on somebody, trying to, you know, looking for redemption. And that was, he said, no, please don't confess all your sins to me. You know, some guy was trying to stop him from doing that. And I'm like, wow, well, they must really... My heart really went out. I remembered also incidents there where he was one of the honchos, you know, stalking people and hurting people. And now he's looking for redemption 3 years ago. But he won't take anything from me or seek me out in any way, shape, or form. That could definitely talk to him about all this stuff, because they can't do that. They have to have redemption another way. And there is no other way. Not the, no, he doesn't have to talk to me for redemption, but I mean, the path that I'm on is the only path, is what I mean. There's only one way to go, right? And so he was trying to lay it on somebody else, and then the camera flipped away, more light to find other people to talk to and say hello to and whatnot. And yeah, there were faces there of people, and they just looked like, not like the kids I remember, but they were all just normal-looking older people that just seemed like they wouldn't do anyone any harm. And I felt so sorry. I just felt like this was supposed to be this fun event, and no one looked like they were having any fun at all. They were just there looking for something, and they didn't know why they were there. And that's what this guy was trying to get me to go to that reunion. That's why he came out of the woodwork to talk to me. And believe me, if I was there, I would have livened things up a lot. But I didn't belong there. So sad. I had to leave childhood. You see, I had to put childhood away. I had to put the music making and the bands away. I had to put away my sense of community and friendship. I wasn't allowed to have any of that. It wasn't that I had to put it away. It's that it was not accorded to me to have, if you know what I mean. I didn't have an option there. I was still trying to find out what the heck was happening years earlier, and then it's still going on, and I'm trying to find out why is this so, does anyone survive this? And then, of course, I'm brought into mind of my friends who were dead, who went to these same schools, who are no longer with us, and they're no longer with us because when their eyes were open to this whole satanic reality, they got jumped on bad, and next thing you know, they're not here anymore. And I'm like, well, I kept looking online like I was thinking I could find something online about it all. Or I would find something in the encyclopedia or something. Nope. It's covered up from one end of this earth to the other, like it doesn't exist, like it never did exist. And it's really, when I think about it today, it's really way above my pay grade. I really don't understand. I just understand the end result of taking souls, taking commodities called souls, on one side or the other of this divide. That's all I know. And the one that's on the world side, the world, quote unquote, is at war with anything that has to do with God or, lambs or, anything, the church or the scriptures or the whatever. I mean, it's at war with anything that has to do with the spirit, because that comes into truth. And when the truth comes in, it wrecks this delusion or illusion of some sort of Disneyland simulacrum world, which is just a simulacrum at best. And they live in it, and they believe it's real. And they point to the trophies on the wall and their Academy Awards and their various things. Oh, see? See? It's like, yeah, I see that you had to be... Somebody else made that happen. Yep, it sure did. And so, there's no real honor there. If you want, ask Kissy Kissy. Just hang around in Hollywood. And if you've done anything of note, the people will be around to kiss your ass. If you think that's real, you're out of your mind. But I just don't think these people are serious. Having seen the video, the sad thing was they were all, looking for something, hoping that a 40-year high school reunion would do the trick, and it just all looked like they were all alienated from each other, and they weren't being fed. They should have had a band there. Something. It seemed like, to me, let me tell you what it was, the experience to me when I saw this video. It was like going to the reception after a funeral. That's exactly what it was like. And indeed, it was like a funeral for my friend that died 3 years later. You look at him in the video, you think, oh, this guy will live on to be 90 years old. No. just out of the blue, death took him. The guy that was tallying up the figures and the odds on all the horse racing, which was basically us. I just found that so bizarre that there was some exchange or market for that. And you know, he was running around, you know, place your bets, really enjoying producing that kind of trauma. That one really was so deep. It took 40 years for me to basically bring that to the surface, to clear it out and forgive. And I totally forgive. I mean, I felt sorry because the video of this guy at this party or whatever, he was just, again, looked like a deer in the headlights, completely lost. Hi, hey, how you doing? Yeah. Oh, hey, what's happening? I almost felt like, you know, what would have done them some good would have been for me to go there and jump up on my soapbox and start preaching at them and say, what the F do you people think you're doing? Just blowing smoke again, whistling by the graveyard? Hey, how many more times like this are you going to have? Answer, none. How many more chances are you going to have to get right with the absolute, with the absolute reality, rather than playing footsie in Disneyland? But that could never happen, of course. There would have been objection. There would have been hostility, to say the least. They weren't ready to hear anything like that, and they probably aren't today. They're probably thinking somehow it's going to work out. Maybe one or two of them might hear this broadcast. They might realize that this broadcast is a bit more than just Zeph, a.k.a. who I used to be, B.C., right before Christ. You know, back in high school, troubled soul, troubled child, whatever. You know, whatever. What good could come out of hopefully they would recognize there's something a little bit more going on than just me or my ego, whatever that is. I think my friends definitely shattered that when I was a kid. They made sure that I didn't have any self-view at all except self-destructive tendencies. That I didn't do to myself. That was done to me. And I realized that. I realized I don't own it. That had circumstances been different, I probably would be more intact. But I am completely intact in the Lord. You know, intact meaning a single focused personality, you know, knowing reality as I do, which most people don't. Hence mentally ill. But if everyone's mentally ill, then that becomes the new norm, right? So, but I mean, a person that's intact, soul, body, mind, and spirit, knows full well what we're facing in death, knows full well what the world is. You know, knows full well what his or her limitations are, and also good points. You know, and I mean, in other words, an intact, reality-based human being, and that's what God makes us. And it may not be easy. It's more fun to have like multiple personalities and be right, because then you don't feel pain. You know, every time some pain, like a trauma comes up, you flip into another thing, and off you go into, you know, you carry them off to another direction. I definitely went through all that, but it was. It's funny how the Lord integrated, you know, all that. Most people I know that have been through trauma, it's like PTSD. If you don't deal with it, it becomes multiple personalities, right? Alters that, you know, for your own survival, to avoid the pain of the trauma, you kind of automatically go into something else, and you'll have to deal with it later. Well, I've dealt with all of this on the Zeph Report, too, because I felt that you could relate, because I found that so many people were just like me. I mean, it was just identical. That's why I'm doing this memoir version today, because it's like identical. You know, when we don't deal with those traumas, we get split, and we get split, and we get split. And it's a survival mechanism. Now, I know they also split. They do trauma-based mind control, which is to split and create alters that they can control that's a military operation. I understand that. That's how they create these shooters and Manchurian candidates and whatnot. You know, that's definitely a very dark field of endeavor, but that is definitely a reality, and that definitely goes on. And I definitely was around that and people that did that. Enter in Dr. Julian West. Well, he's no longer on the planet. He's gone. But it was so weird. I remember standing in his home that he was building when it was just sticks up in Bel Air overlooking UCLA, where he was head of the UCLA Neuropsychiatric Institute, or NPI, they called it. And it was like in this building, and they had a little volleyball court on the roof. I don't know if they still have it, but that was his. And he would experiment on the children. It was mainly kids there. And he'd experiment on with drugs, with all kinds of drugs. And, you know, it's like, you need a Manchurian candidate? Here's your batch right here at NPI. Anyway, so I was told by his daughter that I was, I guess, kind of dating. I don't know. There was a weird thing there. I felt she was, like, handling me. But, I mean, I'm 17. Come on. I'm a kid. But we're standing there. I remember there's another guy there that I knew from my altered childhood. And I think he had the hots for her, too. She was very pretty, this girl. And, you know, my dad's a psychiatrist. Oh, really? Yeah, he's head of the NPI. See, UCLA. He goes, oh, you got a nice view of UCLA. You got a view of, you know, you go down the hill and then cross the street and you're at UCLA. And there's his department right there, right at the very top of the building there. So you got a nice view of that. So there were just sticks. House hadn't been done yet. He was just settling in. Now, what are the odds that I would have that experience? Isn't that strange? Don't you find that interesting if you're, you know, in the conspiracy thing and, you know, how that fits? No, I have nothing to report. He didn't do anything to me, you know. I mean, it was just like, except throw his daughter at me to kind of keep tabs on me. So there was that. But that's about it. Anyway, and looking back on all that, even that was really strange. But again, all this stuff, and then the predatory nature of the satanic Los Angeles, you know, having all these kids committing suicide and being taken out, you know, and I just found that these are kids that, for whatever reason, through no fault of their own, ladies and gentlemen, seriously, they couldn't be like the other kids. They were just born the way they were. I remember they were dear friends of mine, too, and they just didn't make it because the world just came down on them for no reason. And then they all manifested like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It was exactly the same thing, where they're all like in this conformity thing. They're all of this hive mind. And like my one friend, I saw him like just before he died, and when we were like 17, and this other guy that was there too, taunting him, and I told you about that, but then he died a little while later because he couldn't handle it, because he wasn't, you know, it shocked him that the world was really run by a thing, because most people don't say they believe in the devil or God or anything like that. And then all of a sudden, the demonic realm surfaces and all their masks come off, and they're all these flaming devils, you know, and it's like, they're not, I mean, it's a horror movie beyond a horror movie. And then you realize you're completely alone and no way out and no help. You go to the shrink, you know, and go, hey, doc, all this is happening. And, well, you sound like you're paranoid and delusional. Here, try some of this drug. You know, we can monitor you at the hospital. And then after a couple of weeks, we'll let you out and, you know, we'll see if we can maintain you at the right level. So, you know, we'll have to write you up as some sort of psychotic for having mentioned this stuff, which, of course, we all know exists. But if you mention it, we put you on medication and throw you to a mental hospital. Now, I could understand at this reunion of the dead, which is really what we should call this high school reunion of the dead, these old classmates. You know, the road not traveled by me, but the road traveled by them. They were all there like at a funeral, all looking for some kind of redemption, for some kind of hope. all looking like just normal citizens that you'd see, you know, any swath of them at an airport or a, you know, a sporting event or a, you know, or a, on the street walking their dog, you know, just normal people. Nothing out of the ordinary, nothing special. Some people very successful there, but, you know, they didn't, there they kind of let their hair down. They didn't look like put on airs or anything. They were just being themselves, looking for something, looking for what they lost 40 years ago. Now, I can see these things, and you might argue with me. You might say, it's not like that, Zeph. It wasn't like that. You're seeing, you're reading into it. You're projecting your own upset that you didn't complete the course, that you were life interrupted or whatever. No, I've worked all that. I don't think so. No, I haven't worked all that out. I'm not that person. I don't care about things like that. I don't have something that I don't have a bucket list. No. I mean, I don't have like regrets. Like, boy, I wish I had done that. Wish I had been there, because there was not possible. So it's not, you don't think about things like that because it wasn't, that there was no possibility. So therefore, no, there's not a regret. I have no regrets. If I had to do it again the same way for the Lord, I do have one regret. I have a regret. Let me be honest. I have a regret. I regret that I didn't, I can't believe, especially after I came out of this coma, this drug-induced coma and all that, where they did try to bump me off, and I barely survived, you know, and my heart had stopped for 20 minutes and all that, and that was very serious, and it was like a, you know, I don't want to go into a lot of the details of that, but let's just put it this way. I remember the people who were involved in it, okay? And one ended up living here in Santa Fe. That's all, he was a teacher, yeah. And I did confront him, and he must have figured it out because he went screaming home back to Colorado. And he's dead by now. He was an old man then. You know, the odds are impossible. 10 trillion to 1 that he'd have that experience. But it confirmed it all in my mind that, yeah, they tried to bump me. They tried to get rid of me, just like my friend and all my other friends that, you know, did me. There's just like an accident, you know, or an accidental suicide, or a guy drives a car off a cliff. You know, it's just that kind of thing. They kill them. This is a little more serious than just being kind of targeted, isn't it, folks? A little more serious than your average TI, wouldn't you say? These are kids. They did nothing. They would have loved to have been at the reunion. Had they been at the reunion, they might not have been like one big funeral. Well, of course it's like a funeral. Because of what I'm talking about today, that's why their reunion was really more a funeral reception. Because of course that's what it became. Not a cause of celebration, but a place to share regrets, to wonder what this was all about, to wonder why these things happened, to wanting to really kind of drop your guards and just confess to one another. But without the Lord, there's no point. It's funny. I think if they knew the Lord was involved, they'd say, well, I better not have that tequila. So I have a whole bottle of tequila. You know, see, that's in their mind. They think, you know, that church programming. So they, you know, of course they're, you know, they're screwed. These people, they're screwed, man. And if they don't wake up, they're just screwed. And they're never going to have another reunion like that. It was amazing that I was on a little video that I could look at. It wasn't intending to find stuff like that. It just came my way. I don't know. So weird. Because I don't go looking into the past and looking for. Every once in a while, somebody pops up, and then you wonder what happened, you know? But I'm not that kind of person. I don't go to reunions or, you know, funeral receptions or whatever. I may go to a funeral, but not a reception. There's no point, you know? It's like, my dad's funeral reception was the last thing I could stand, and they were doing the same thing there. They were all wanting to confess and, you know, why things didn't go better and filled with regret. And I have to say to my old classmates, if you go on and have another the next time you have a reception like that, a party like that, it will be for your fellow schoolmate's funeral. That's where you're going to start going to those funerals. And it's going to look much the same as your high school reunion. So no, I'm not mad at you for whatever you did or didn't do, you know, for whatever there was a perceived wrong there with this one guy there was. But I think the Lord brought all that up and his obit up and that video up where he was in it, happy as can be, or not really happy, but no one there was happy. Not even the most successful people that had such worldly success, you'd think they should be totally happy. They weren't happy. They were looking for something. Something that I have found. I know what they want, but they just don't know how to get it, and they're not going to take it from me, so there's no point in going on with it. They want what we all want. They want to know that their life has meaning. They want to know if they could be forgiven for the things they've done, for whenever they did them. Can they forgive themselves? Will there ever be a cause for joy again, or do we just live like old men with regrets and traumas? Because when you do a perpetrating thing against another human being and then one of your classmates dies because of it, and you're carrying that all your life, you got away with murder. But you didn't really. You're carrying that guilt all your life. I've seen it even shape the decisions of certain projects that got done. We're obviously showing that these people felt guilty. They would do things that... And then others are not that fully conscious, you know, not that reactionary. They're just kind of existing and taking up space and, you know, scared to death of death. But gave me the opportunity to really let go. And that's why it's such a sunny, beautiful day today. To really let go. You know, to really... How can I put it? To really be at peace. To really know, as I knew years ago, though, you know, I knew a long time ago, but to know that I, you know, just like that I went, you know, it may have been a hard road in a way. The decisions I made kind of look like mistakes back then, but it was all the right way. It was the only way for me. And I would, like I say, do it exactly the same again if need be. I never felt like I really was ever going to permanently live on Earth. I never felt that this was any more than a castle on the sand, a sand castle, and that we're just passing through. And that was one of the reasons why this stuff didn't quite work. Because I always knew that. I knew that there was no permanence, no real tradition, and no other significant others in the way of friends, really. They're people we share space with and we're nice to each other and try to help one another. But basically, you got to come in here alone, you go out alone. You got to find your peace. The other guy can't find it. You can't find it as a collective. Your high school reunion is going to be nothing but depressing because you can't find it there. But I see how this one guy was going around trying to confess something to somebody, and the guy was telling him not to. And I thought, wow, there's a clue as to, you know, there was something there that I wondered if that moment would ever come in this man's life, if he would ever regret some of the things that he did to others. Others who are not here right now, if he would ever have a regret, like, gosh, I wish I wasn't so mean to that guy who committed suicide just because he, you know, he didn't see it my way. I wish I had been nicer. I wish he had been here at this reunion. He was a really nice guy. We really loved him, and it was all great when we were kids, and then this thing happened. And he's dead, and I'm alive, and I'm you know, I've thrived, and he's dead. And he's dead maybe because of me in some way. And yet my life has thrived, and yet he's dead. Can I really ever? It's Dasha. Come here now. Talk to the people there. Say hello. Jump up here. Come on, jump up here. She's huge, folks. And when she runs, the FedEx guy is scared to death of her. And she's just a puppy. But when she runs at you, it's, you look at the look on her face, and it's like the fiercest police dog you've ever seen. She looks like a police dog, German Shepherd. She's a weapon. And I always walk the guy to his truck, right? I walk him to his truck. There she goes. See what I mean? If she hears the slightest thing, a car can be coming from a mile away, and she hears it. And then, you know, you got to be locked and loaded, right? So if the wrong car comes up here, you know what to do. Anyway, so look, the point is, there are some insights here shared today that could not have been shared unless I had a joyful heart. If I had bitterness or regret or guilt or unfair guilt, meaning, you know, I've taken guilt upon myself that I owned something I didn't own. If there hadn't been some kind of healing that was supernatural in nature, we would not be having this conversation that I know has helped all of you, because all of you have had, if not identical, pretty darn close experiences to what I just gave you as a mini memoir. Everything is supernatural. The idea of running into this guy again, you know, and having him tell me I was on a long journey trying to reel me into this reunion, then seeing the video of the reunion, him alive, then seeing the obituary, then that triggering the memory of that party at his house with all these people there, and that whole traumatic thing that happened so bad that really messed me up. I mean, I couldn't bring it to remembrance until yesterday. And then I realized that when I got triggered, when he contacted me, that it was like I shut him off, you know, like, but I didn't know why. Because it was like danger. And it was dealing with that trauma. The key to that is, if you want to be friends with someone, don't traumatize them. Or if you want to be friends with them again, help them to heal from the trauma that you inflicted on them. I mean, I'm going to heal anyway, because I'm not going to blame this guy. He was just part of a bigger machine that just crushed him. Just crushed him. Just took him out this planet. Boom. And thing is, of course, he was a really nice guy until he became double-minded. As everyone is, when you go through the double deception, you know, into the matrix, you decide you're going to go into the matrix and have this sort of, you know, feigned, you know, I'm sorry, not feigned, what's the word, right word, this kind of double life. And so he's no longer the kid that was just the single-minded nice kid. He was now the double-minded, nice on the one hand, but had this other thing on the other. Not, couldn't be trusted by, you know, people like me. Because he sees us as Satan sees us, as a commodity that's not behaving right. We have to get him, you know, and rack him and stack him. Now, invasion of the body snatchers, whatever you want to call it. But make no mistake, people, these people at this, I'm looking at this as like a laboratory of the whole world. And this small group of people, they're looking for redemption. Look at them. They're standing around, they're drinking, and they're talking, and they're being polite, just like normal people that you'd see. But you could see the regret and the being lost and the, ha, it's great. Hey, how you doing? What happened? You know, there was that pall over the whole thing, a pall, like a pall of death. And indeed, one of them would be leaving in just 3 years hence. But the ones that were gone already, that weren't there, were being, it looked to me like in some way they were being lamented, because these people there, they never dealt with the trauma of that. So it was like unfinished business. And before that business gets finished, they die. So sad that one could cry a whole lifetime over it, but we're not here to just cry. We are here to find out a couple of things. One, why we're here. I thought you said we're here because, we're here because someone put us here. We're here to discover what that person who put us here, what the plan was or is for us, if there is one. In other words, the whole duty of man is to serve God. Now, all the people here, though, and everything created serves God anyway. But for that, what's built into us, and it was obviously built into the people there at that funeral, I mean high school reunion, the thing they're looking for is within them, obviously, and the kingdom is within us, and reality is within us. They know, and they cannot help each other, folks. They can't redeem themselves with each other. They can't confess their sins to each other and do any better than just have sorrow and lament and regret. The only thing that's going to help them is the Lord Jesus Christ, God Almighty, the Word of God, etc. You know, I mean, that's the only thing that's going to help them. But the churches are so corrupt that they felt that there's nowhere to go, and they can't trust anyone, and they can't trust each other. As you could see from, as I could see from the video, they're not about to trust each other. It's like, yeah, well, we got to do it again. Yeah, hey, how about we get together for a barbecue? And Oh, yeah, we're not going to get together for any barbecue, are we? Maybe another high school reunion will do it. And every year, there's less people around, right? Every year, there's less of them until there's only a couple left. If you don't know why you live and who you are and what you are and why you are, if you're not conscious at any level, any way, shape, or form, then you're asleep. You're hypnotized. You know you need to wake up. You know you need something. And your friend there can't give it to you. And your family can't give it to you. And your high school ring won't do it for you. If there is such a thing as a high school ring, as college rings, but can't do it for you. Your school can't do it for you. I'm thinking of the Pink Floyd line. We're just two lost souls in a fishbowl. How does that go, Trish? Two lost souls in a fishbowl year after year. You know, running around year after year. In other words, we're just two lost souls in a fishbowl. It was from the song Wish You Were Here. I'm sorry, I've mangled it. Two lost souls in a fishbowl year after year. We're just two lost... What?
Was that us?
What?
Two lost souls in a fishbowl?
You and me?
Question mark?
No, that's the lyrics go, we're just two lost souls living in a fishbowl, swimming in a fishbowl year after year.
Oh, I don't remember that lyric.
In other words, it looks like someone lamenting someone that had died. But, you know, the world is just lost souls swimming in a fishbowl year after year. Well, without the Lord, that's what it is.
Exactly.
And, you know, like at that high school reunion, they're looking to each other for help, and there's just no help available. They need something. That's why they went there. If they had already, they wouldn't have had to go to a reunion. And they're looking for something they can't give each other. They're looking for something that doesn't exist. You know, and all this compassion for people that enjoyed doing people like me in. And did my friends in. Their schoolmates. They did them in. Oh, there may not be linkage. It may have been a suicide or something, you know. Just a tragic thing. No, nobody has to take the blame. You know, not so much connective tissue is what I'm suggesting. Of course, I'm open to saying, yeah, we all killed everybody. I mean, you know, sure. But I'm talking about specifically gang stalking, bullying, traumatizing people that leads to a suicide or leads to an event. If you participated in that in any way, shape, or form, being mean or playing part of a game or doing a carry episode of inviting someone somewhere to a party or something, then jumping on them, you know, that kind of thing, then you're guilty. And you want a place to go with that guilt. You feel responsible for their death, don't you? Aren't you? And, you know, an accomplice at least. You're too young to really understand. You thought you were running and gunning and running with the pack, and you got it made, baby. You got it sussed. It's just all, you know, peaches and cream from here on out. I mean, you know, but when you're going to make an omelet, you got to break a few eggs. That's all. Don't feel guilty about it. But you do feel guilty, don't you, of what I'm saying? You'll never admit it. Because what I'm talking about doesn't exist. You can't. You didn't think that one day you'd come smack dab and face to face with yourself again, right? Because you, your soul, wants redemption. You want redemption. Don't you? I think we all do. I mean, certainly I've done things and been, I mean, I got blamed for someone's death. And now that I look at it, maybe I had something to do with it. I didn't do it on purpose, but it seemed like I was being programmed by something supernatural. You know, got her to fall in love with me, this gal that was very troubled. And then I rejected her after leading her on. And I mean, you know, that's just called breaking someone's heart. And then she killed herself. And her friend, who was her best friend in a position to know, blamed me. Like, why did you even get involved with her? And I just explained by going, well, I was screwed up at the time myself. I mean, I was having a real problem, you know. I had no business having a relationship with anyone. Anyway, it really kind of came home when it was her best friend who knew her intimately well, who blamed me. Specifically me, like out of anything else to blame, it was really all my fault. So I guess I did have something to do with it. I did traumatize this girl, she was, you know, or trigger her into an episode she didn't survive. It may have looked at the time that I was being arrogant and mean when I was just, you know, trying to survive myself, trying to get away from her because I felt that she was part of some plot against me. So I became like, screw you, you know, yeah, I don't need you. Mean, right? And then she wound up dead. I think it was all a big misunderstanding. But I was under fire too. And maybe that's the way it is with a lot of us and a lot of this. But what I saw and witnessed, and I see beyond the surface, you know, I see various realms and dimensions, I do. That goes to motives and prophetic things, you know, that happens with me. I can see that in general, all these high school reunions are people looking for something they felt they lost. Well, how do I deal with my guilt over, first of all, there was no harm intended, like some of these satanic people when they got going with the Satanism, they intended harm. I didn't intend harm to this girl. It was more under the realm of surviving myself and realizing I was in over my head. And I was in no position to have a relationship with anyone. So I forgave myself And I forgave her friend for blaming me. I realized that I don't own it. It wasn't like I went up, like she was having an awakening that this is a horrible satanic world. She already knew what the world was. You know, I was the one that was like hypnotized and trying to make it like Leave It to Beaver, and then it wasn't, you know what I mean? And she, I felt she was trying to handle me in some way, so I became mean. Cold. You know, I told you I had to learn how to turn it off. Like, you know, you don't exist to me. And apparently that sent her over the edge, but she was already over the edge. You know, when I look back on it, I think in a way I kept her alive longer than she would have been otherwise. So it's, you know, tragedy upon tragedy. But do I feel, you know, responsible? I really don't. I have felt responsible for other people having hard times and traumas. Yes, I've done my share, but I've been forgiven. Man, I forgive. The Lord's forgiven me. And I, you know, in walking with the Lord, I just don't do things like that to people. I don't play games like that. They want to play games, well, you know. But I haven't, you know, been, it just hasn't come around that I have a game. I mean, there's been some stuff here and there, but it got quelled, it got kind of dealt with before it got serious. And I think people can understand that. In other words, the Lord didn't exempt me from all these things that happen. But there are, and this is the point of this talk, a tremendous amount of victims that people are responsible for. For example, if you're on Satan's side of things and you're taunting a lamb, you know, controlling him, you know, making fun of him, you know, having, you know, theater, gaslighting him, you know, little skits, you know, inviting him place and then traumatizing him, you know, because he doesn't know any better. He doesn't know the world you live in. He doesn't know the big, deep, dark secret. So you're torturing him. That's a different category. You need to be, only God can forgive you for that one. And you need to finally forgive yourself. But yeah, you did that. That's a little different than my circumstance. But my circumstance, you know, I did, you know, could have been, you know, I'm participating. I'm looking like one of those devils too. And so I just say, Lord, if I need to be forgiven for this, then let me be forgiven. I mention it to show how none of us are perfect, no matter what side of the equation you're on. But there is an equation. There are two sides. And usually the people on the side of the devil or the world, they have vengeance toward anyone that doesn't agree with them or anyone who doesn't see what they see or isn't like them. And that's just plain wrong. And people that live their lives that way, by the time they get to be 50, 60 years old, they're filled with regrets. You know it. The guilt is stopping them from being able to go on in anything but so. They could be totally successful, and the more successes that come in, the more sorrowful they become because they can't enjoy anything. So they go to their reunions or they're this or they're that looking for something. But in our society, for whatever reason, God is hard to find. The thing you need, the Lord, is hard to find. The world's way is not redemption. The world's way is not salvation. The world's way is, it's a power, it's a force to be reckoned with, and something people hook up with to be successful in life, to get money, to get, right, to live. But it cannot redeem you. All it can do is take your soul and kill you after giving you the illusion that you have an eternal life in Disneyland. Nope, the Disneyland ride ends, and now at 50 and 60 years old, you're told to get the F out. Time for the next batch of lost souls. Am I right or am I right? Hey, look, I survived all this to tell. How many people have done that? You won't even find one, probably. Maybe you will, but have lived this long to tell, to be able to sum it all up so that you out there can get what you need so you can get help. Because I'm telling you, year after year from here, it's going to be almost impossible for some of you to keep the facade up. And what does Satan demand the first, after the day of your initiation? What does he demand? He demands that you keep the facade up at all times. And he demands that you let him do the driving and you just enjoy the ride. Am I right? And then it leads to a dead end. Eventually, not right away. Convincing you that the whole path is obviously the only way to go. And then when that guilt comes rushing back in and that conscience corrects itself, which it will. Oh boy, now what do? We go to high school reunions looking for something, but not being able to bring it to mind because we can't go there. We can't go there. We can't unravel the programming. We can't wake up. Because if we did, we'd really be in trouble. So, it's my hope. You know, at AR, I've spent another podcast reaching out to you worlders. And what do I get in response most of the time? Rocks thrown at me. I mean, I must be some kind of masochist to keep putting up with you. You know, I know enough not to go to high school reunions. Yes. You mean going to my own human sacrifice? No, thank you. But, you know, you're going to have to own up to that. I mean, we don't live in that world. We, you know, the world is hard. And, you know, the rocks get thrown. And the misunderstandings between people hurt. And you know, that happens on both sides. You know, we hurt each other. I hurt other people. They hurt me. I mean, yeah, it happens. But that's the risk you take to have relationships. We all got to hurt each other. And we all seem to at times be, you know, we can all be devils at times and angels, but there are still our two sides. At the end of the day, it's not like, you know, it just depends what you're on. I mean, if you're on the Lord's side, then obviously you're anathema to the world side. And, you know, you're the opposite energy source. And, you know, the Lord is the one who guides our steps. But yet can we who are following the Lord hurt each other? Of course. Look what David did. You know, got people killed by lying and stuff. I mean, you know, all kinds. Look what Solomon did when he had everything. You know, a kingdom that will never be duplicated on this earth and never has been. Wealthiest person that ever lived by a margin that is so far beyond even the most high-up Rothschild member as to make them look like peanuts. More wealth than any man who ever lived or any kingdom that ever existed. Extraordinary. But he, you know, went to the dark side. And went into the occult. Lost the kingdom. It was broken up forever. And then as an old man, you know, he repented and he still had a wisdom because the Lord gave him the gift of wisdom without repentance. And as an old man, he wrote the book of Ecclesiastes, one of the wisest documents. Maybe it's the wisest of all. So your homework assignments, boys and girls, okay? Here at the Zephyr Report, we are in school. There's no high school reunion. School is in, and this is school forever. School's in forever. Sorry, Alice Cooper, but school is in forever. Our assignment is to look at the book of Ecclesiastes from front to end, paying particular attention to the 12th chapter. I'm not going to read it for you here. I think you understand that it all sums up to mean serving the Lord and fear of the Lord and service to the Lord is the whole duty of man, period. The rest is vanity. The rest doesn't matter. What we did, what we didn't do, what we said, what we didn't say, who we hurt, who committed suicide, who did this, who did that. In the end, what matters is that we repent. I can't undo those bad things I've done to other people. I can only lay my life down for the Lord and say, please help me, Lord, take me. I repent. I just want to be your will. Now, for me, I have the luxury of having been broken. In other words, what you out there in the world perceive to have done hurting me, it actually helped me because it broke me so the Lord could use me. It worked out just like that. My one regret that I told you I had is that I never finished that thought, so let me finish it now. I have one regret in the world, and that's that when I was being broken as a teenager, why didn't I just lay my life down? I'll tell you, one problem was my neighbor, who was a very talented artist. I remember we were living in Beverly Hills, and I don't know what his parents were into, but it was a, you know, it was the middle class of Beverly, you know, living between Sunset and Santa Monica, if you know that area, okay? Nice little houses stacked upon each other, pretty much. But anyway, he was the guy that had the carpool, and he said that, you know, and I ran into him later in a reunion, in my own reunion with him, just him personally, he said that I always seemed like a troubled soul. But he, I guess, conspiring with my parents, took me down to a tent revival in Costa Mesa, California, with no one other than Chuck Smith. Now, I was 17. There was no Calvary Chapel back then. It was just Chuck Smith in the tent. The old-fashioned revival. And what did I see when I was there? Well, they had an altar call. Well, they were pulling hippies in and kids on drugs and straightening them up and turning them into the Invasion of the Body Snatchers. In other words, the whole place was a nice set of false teeth. There was no Holy Spirit. Nothing. Nothing for me. Nothing but hostility. I should have known. So I went there. Well, my friend that I had a reunion with, he broke company with me because of my podcast, because of what I said about the church, what I found at church. And I meant to say, look, friend, keeping names out of it here, you know, you took me down there assuring me that you had met God, you've been born again, and you wanted me to get some help. You know, everyone wanted me to get some help. So you took me down there to see if they could help me become a worlder. I mean, that's what it was. You took me down to the Chuck Smith Tent Revival, what was soon to become this big-time Calvary Chapel, and it was just like CIA agents. I mean, it might as well have been. You know what I'm saying? Double agents. And I went to the altar call, and there was no Holy Spirit. There was nothing but, will you obey us? You know, here's some literature. Come back. Be a part of this. But there was nothing there for me to be a part of, friend. You lied to me when you said this was efficacious. This was Jesus. This was the Lord, and the Lord wasn't there. I mean, well, but the Lord had to give the increase. If you look at how fabulously successful in Jesus' name this place became, that wouldn't happen unless the Lord was there. Well, I don't know what happened. The Lord was not there then, and when I went back to the Calvary Chapel out in Encino or wherever it was, when we lived in Sherman Oaks, California, I tried once again, and I went there. There was no Holy Spirit and no God there. There were just people doing satanic ritual abuse. I mean, I don't know why I see stuff. Well, the problem, Zeph, was you didn't drink the Kool-Aid. I guess had I drank the Kool-Aid, I would have realized it's all about this junta. It's all about giving your individuality up for the group and becoming part of the collective. And then, yeah, they'll let you be a Christian. Well, that doesn't work for me. I needed help. Real help. And it wasn't there. And it wasn't at this church. And it wasn't in any church. How do I expect my old schoolmates to, you know, get anywhere? Because all that they have is like the official state-run, state-owned church. Yes, you go there, and that's where you get Jesus. And we know it's all fake, so we're not going there. So they're looking to each other for help that they can't give each other because only God can give them the help they need, but they're cut off. By the people playing this dangerous deception game of church. They're the ones who cut them off. Now I've pretty much forgiven all that. I've let that go. You know, I don't even know. I think the reason that I went to the Calvary Chapel at all was to remember what happened in Costa Mesa. I was so traumatized and I was just desperate for help. To feel like this nightmare could be over, that I could belong to something, if I could have, if I didn't understand what was going on, it was just so freaky. But there was no help. I got more help in an ashram than I did with that. Not that that's not slavery too, it's all slavery, but, you know, so, gosh, man, what a weird trip, man. What a weird world. What a very, very messed up world, a sick world it is. I mean, I don't see how this thing even goes one more day. But I see the Lord using it for his, somehow, the Lord is using it for good. He somehow, I look, you know, I'm watching our Lord. And I'm watching how he's dealing with this Russia, you know, and these false flag terror attacks and all the rest of it. And I'm watching, you know, politics and Donald Trump and, you know, the things you see flashing across your internet screens. You know, I'm looking at all that going, wow, it's just, and seeing the workings of the Lord rather than just seeing the conspiracy only. Do you understand what I mean? So I forgave yesterday. I didn't realize I had forgiveness to do on that one, that traumatic party that I went to. I forgot all about that. I guess that'd been gnawing at me and working at me and probably developing some cancer in me all these years. I didn't even realize it. How I was so hurt by that, I never recovered, folks. And until now, I mean, you talk about a delay, that's like a 42-year delay. I imagine people that have been in Auschwitz and been raped and been hurt, you know, you're probably going through the same thing, trying to blot it out, but it just doesn't work. Let me propose to you the way we ought to behave to the innocent in our society. After all, that's what we're talking about, right? The innocent and the guilty. The guilty should be grateful that there are innocent around and should understand that if they bless God's children, the innocent, then they in turn will be blessed and may even be given a way out or a redemption possibility. But if they curse the children of God, they will be cursed and taken out with vehemence. Just saying. That's what I've observed. The Lord will bless those that bless his children. Well, that's the Jews. Oh, come on. God has his children everywhere. And you know who they are. They're the ones who are not in your club. Well, some of those get messed up and become drug addicts and prostitutes and petty criminals, and I'm sure awful. But they have one thing that you don't have. And it doesn't mean to say that they're all God's children either. There's plenty of deception to go around. For example, you think, oh, if they're homeless, they're God's children. There's a lot of homeless that play the game, that are there, rounding them up and keeping tabs on and being honchos of the homeless. Yep, just like that. Same thing, different category, but it's the same dynamic that goes on. So my proposal is this. If you bless God's, you know, you have to have discernment to know who they are. Certainly, I don't look like God's child to people, you know, who have a stereotypical view of it. I don't look like that at all. But I claim that my survival proves beyond all doubt that there's a supernatural agent in place, and it can't be the devil, because the devil cannot extend people's lives beyond that which they ordained, how far they are ordained to go. Nope, not possible. Only God knows the length of our lives. The devil can twist and use things and use people, turn people against each other, and, you know, have people handle each other and assign people to each other, and he can do all that twisting and perverting. But he cannot extend your life one more day that it was preordained to go. That includes people that are dead when they're children, people that are taken out when they're, you know, aborted, people are taken out in the crossfire of these terrible wars started by these neocons and, you know, globalists, and you know, they're actually all secret society members. I don't know, people are going to go Zionist. Now, Zionism is too narrow a term. These are Satanists. You know, sure, they may claim to be, you know, Jews, but are, you know, in some cases, but they are the, you know, synagogue of Satan. And, of course, it's mixed. There are people from all over the world and all different ethnic backgrounds involved in it. So you can't just go, are these Semitic Jews, or these people over here, or these, you know, Catholics over there, or these, it's... The society is deeper than that. It's before all the churches. I mean, that's what you sell out into. They're the ones who pull your chain, isn't it? They're the ones who write your paycheck, right? You ought to know who you gave your life to, because it is your life that you gave up in order to have a life. So ironic. So now you're looking for that life back. That's called redemption. It's available. I've tried to explain it to you. I don't know if I've done a good job or not, but I'm going to stop right now. God help us all. But my proposal still stands. You bless the children of God, that which you perceive to be the children of God, and you will be blessed. If you don't know what to do right now, just bless somebody else. But the society that decides to eradicate certain sects, look, they tried to do this at Salem under the guise of, we got to kill the witches, right? The witch trials, or burning witches at the stake, where in whatever community. They always end up burning lambs. Well, I don't know why. Or the Inquisition would get, you know, the pure in heart, or people that had a relationship with God, because they'd say that's of the devil, you know what I mean? Because they don't have that. And so they seek to get rid of that, the children of God, to eradicate them from the face of the earth. And what happens is their society collapses. Their empire collapses. Why? Because without the equilibrium, you cannot exist, because it's God's law. If you know that, you'll have plenty of a supply of lambs around if you happen to be an evil ruler. And someone who has power over such things, you'd make sure there are plenty of lambs around to ensure your sustenance and your power stay intact. I mean, even though that's a very cynical game, that's the only option you'd have if you want to stay the course of your vain little life. If you eradicate the lambs from the earth, you, king, aren't there anymore. And neither is anybody else. The society collapses, it ceases to exist, and it's back to barbarism. And, you know, slaying each other in the streets and beheadings and, oh, you mean kind of like now? Yeah, yeah. That's where we're headed now because of this problem. That's why my proposal is the opposite of the way the world has been behaving. Oh, I know you're not going to do it. But, you know, this result... terrorism every week, World War III going on in Syria between Russia and the United States, proxy war using Turkey, NATO, ISIS being a confabulation of the United States, managed and heavily produced by the PGA Producers Guild of America. Crane shots, dolly shots, costumes, hair, makeup. Give me a break. Okay? I joke, but with real beheadings, which makes all these people scumbags, obviously. Selling out for the money, right? They don't have to actually be there at the beheading, but it's good money. Oh, we blew that shot out of the beheading. Joe, you got another one? Yeah. Okay, get the other guy in here. That one, I didn't get the shot of the head coming off right. Okay, we have to, okay, let me just get an insert shot of just the head just coming away from the body. Thanks, Joe. Okay, lock it up, pictures up, okay. And rolling, speed, and action. Okay, just okay, rolling, okay, speed, and action. Okay, start sawing the head off. Beautiful. Okay, got it. That's a print. All right, that's a wrap, folks. Thanks for a nice day. Really? Really? I mean, tell me it's not like that. tell me that's a fantasy in my own mind. I've actually had people write me telling me that don't think it's so fantasy. I mean, you how you come up with stuff, Zeph. But, you know, makes you look like you're on the inside and say it can't be that bad. I hope to pray to God that I just like in the Riverside thing. You know, we got to talk about this for a minute, and then I'm going to go. The Riverside thing stinks to high heaven, like they all do, and it makes me feel really bad. That's why I had to start doing the business of forgiving the leftists who don't mind the terror attacks. I know, because they feel the terror attacks are being used to get the guns, so it's okay to have some collateral damage if the end result is to get the gun. So all the liberals I know, you know, that I see, like on Twitter, and they're all, you know, kind of savvy, knowing that these attacks are used to get the guns, and so they look the other way on them. Not all of them, you know, people with a heart don't, but a lot of these people have no heart anymore. You talk about being sold out. Some of these, but usually, and you know, it's Republicans too. I mean, it's not just a political class, but there's a certain kind of person on Twitter that they actually are applauding the, you know, ISIS and the terror attacks. And anyone who talks against ISIS is, you know, it's ridiculous. The thing that should be done right now is you just have, you're talking about stopping immigration. But really, you're not talking about immigration. You're talking about an invasion of males at fighting age being brought in to become activated in cells to then be at the ready to pull more terror attacks off so they can do more political stuff. I mean, that's what it looks like to me. You know, a way to take the rights away from the people, to stage these attacks and then force laws that people otherwise wouldn't accept. Isn't that what's going on here? Isn't that what 9/11 was about? Isn't that what the San Bernardino is about? Isn't that what all of this is about? All these shootings, Sandy Hook, all of it. So the president can get out his pen and go, anyone that's on a no-fly list has to turn their guns in. If it becomes, you know, what they really want is total gun confiscation. Would they not stage attacks to get their way, if that's what it came down to? Since we're in a war, yeah, people die. Yeah, that's what they would do. So that's not a stretch. Would they have an ISIS there to scare everybody to death so that they demand world government? Of course. Would they then be reluctant to bomb ISIS or say they're bombing ISIS when they're doing no such thing and send leaflets down to make sure they stay alive? Yes, they would. Would they be traitors to America? Yes, they are. Are they criminals to America? Yes, they are, but nobody does anything about it. But are people really fed up and sick of it? Yes, they know. Look, I got a good friend, and I started talking about, you know, this whole false flag thing. He doesn't believe a word of it. And he's a very smart guy. We agree on just about everything, but he doesn't believe a word of it. Even not believing a word of it, still, then you look at, okay, bad leadership, bringing these people in when they should be stopped. Bad leadership on purpose, even. He'll go that far. He won't go so far as to say that somehow there's collusion between the federal government and possibly terrorist groups to bring about attacks that would otherwise that then would be used for political purposes. I mean, he won't go that far. He just can't go there. Right, Trish?
Yeah.
But that's okay, isn't it? You know, the only reason I don't want to go that far, I believe in the country. You know, I told you I had this perception of the FBI, some kind of a vision of this reform, and I'm hoping that carries on to the rest of them. I don't care what they've done. What's important now is that we straighten up. You know, that's what's important, that we repent. Knock it off. If someone orders, you know, black ops to go in somewhere and do some awful thing, stand down. No, I know that's not in place now, but I mean, it's my hope that we can have it. Look, maybe I want too much. You know, I would like the news media to actually tell the news rather than lie every day. I would love to see some of those reforms. And I say here to the FBI. I always believed in the FBI, you know, but I believed in them for other reasons. I believed in the founding of the FBI because they went after communists. And so I have a problem with that because that's the face of Satanism. That's a political face directly of Satanism, of degradation, immorality, you know, a death to the human spirit, subjugation, slavery, and all the rest of it. So yes, I would be against that. But it's a result, communism, of the mass of people selling out to Satan that doesn't exist and never happened, according to the people. They would never admit such a thing. But it's a numbers game. When a certain number, it's all about equilibrium. The whole reality is based on that. When a certain number go through, then the society changes to become totalitarian. And then it collapses eventually. You could just say they went decadent. And there's no secret Cracker Jack box with a little toy inside. Fine! However you want to describe it. When it's a numbers game, like I said, I'll explain it again. Because it seems that you just are so hard of hearing. When a certain number of people in a nation go through to the other side, the dark side, the side of death, whatever, the death cult, whatever you want to call it. It's formal, and it's cosmic, and it's light to dark, dark to light. It's a huge deal. When the majority goes to that, the society collapses. It goes totalitarian, it goes to dictatorship, ultimately collapses. When there is balance between the two sides, the society can thrive. No one is saying that in this world you get rid of one side or the other. The reason Satan wants all the lambs eradicated is so humanity itself will be then destroyed. Game over. God doesn't get his creation. Done. That's a foolish position since Satan is a created being called Lucifer. I said, well, that's all a myth, Zayof. Well, yeah, you're a myth. You're more of a myth than that is. Whatever you want to call it, there is a devil. There was an offer made to Jesus that he could have all the kingdoms of the world if he would just bow down and lift Satan above God. So to the people that have formally done that, in their little clubs, in their secret societies, in their Masonic lodges, in their football games, their fraternity sororities, whatever, however they got it done, to the extent that that becomes the majority and the lambs wither, is the extent the society collapses in direct, geometric, mathematical, algebraic proportions. Have I made myself quite abundantly clear? And if you want the basis for that. It's the story of Sodom and Gomorrah when Abraham was pleading the Lord as to how many people would be allowed, how many people had to be intact for the Lord not to strike that city down. If you do the math, then you will understand. The Lord is very merciful. Most people don't do it. They just say, oh, he's a psychopath. Well, let me just go back to Sodom and Gomorrah, the kind of things they're doing. First of all, they were sacrificing children and drinking their blood. You agree? Approve or disapprove? They may have had every kind of sex going on too, but you know, they were basically steeped in the occult and in human sacrifice and cannibalism. And they eradicated all the lambs. So it was just them feeding now upon each other. In other words, an abomination unto God. And people go, no, it's all about sodomy. But no, it is not. That story is not about sodomy. Sodomy is just maybe one, you know, it's like something people engage in. So what? That's not what caused the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. It was called wickedness. It has to do with the fact that, you know, the people there wanted to rape the angels, sodomize them. In other words, it was the preying upon the innocents until there were no more innocents. And when it gets down to a certain number, as I said before, for the umpteenth time, that then triggers a reaction, which is the end of that city, or the end of America, or the end of Europe, or the end of the global system as we know it, which then is win-win, ka-ching, ka-ching, for the enemy, Satan, who is the enemy of all the people that sold out. Every last one of you people that sold out to Satan, he is your enemy and wants you dead. You're just a useful idiot, a stooge, for now. So he pays you some trinkets while you're a useful idiot, and then he tosses you out. Be glad you're not dead. Okay, enough of the rant. I can't say it any better than that, Trish. I cannot, absolutely, there is no way that I can lay it down better than that. You know, back in the day of being 17 and trying to get some help from Chuck Smith and the Costa Mesa revival going on, I was just a confused kid. I had no preconceptions about the world or anything. I was just looking for help. And help they did not offer. They offered slavery in exchange for being deemed a good person of society. In other words, they'd get you off the drugs and put you to work and get you all hooked up and everything. In other words, they'll enslave you, but they wouldn't help you. And Chuck Smith made a huge living off enslaving lots of people.
And we learned a little bit about Chuck Smith.
His business practices, that's right, or the way he rolls. He rips people off. I mean, the late Chuck Smith. I don't say God rest in peace because I see him as an enemy. I don't see him as a friend, but a foe. I say good riddance. You know, hopefully that organization will collapse. Well, it's too strong. It's too many people, and it's too big to fail. It's got the... God loves it. No, God doesn't love it. God has allowed it to thrive. But it thrives for the wrong reasons. It's simply another corporation thriving. I mean, God's allowed lots of corporations to thrive. I mean, what's your point? So many people have written to me who went through that system and agree with me that it's just unbelievable. So like every other person, not every other, but every person, with the exception of one every distant once in a while. But the rest of them all agree. They've come out of there and they go, my God, it was just nothing but, I was just kept almost like in a state of a coma spiritually. They just want numbers, you know. There's a lot of those. No, I don't care if they have any lineage. There's one in Maui we saw, in South Maui. We saw one in, you know, they have these little outlets everywhere, these little kiosks. And what they want is, you know, social conformity, no individuality, you know, everybody working as a team, hive mind, the collective, the same. And then they want to keep you in the seat by telling you all about the rapture of all things, which makes them absolute idiots. You know, they're idiotic regarding the Bible. They don't know what they're talking about. You know, they have a very surface understanding of the Bible, and they have no clue because they don't, you know, unless you're going to come. The whole point of the Bible, okay, is to lay your life down for the Lord. You know, to live for God. You know, I mean, that's basically it. Not the collective, okay? It's an individual thing. It's an individual walk. And to pounce on that and criticize that and put that down is anathema to Jesus and what he really represents, what it really is. In a sense, they block salvation. And it's not just them. It's all the 501c3s. It's all the surface stuff out there. It's only going to tell you one thing. I don't care what institution it is, Harvard University, the XYZ church on the corner, the library, what books they have that don't have, the news media when you turn on the TV itself, all the programming. It's all going to tell you one thing. It's all going to tell you one thing. You know, it's going to teach you to stay the course and that the church is there to allay your guilt, to make you have a feeling or a similitude of redemption when it's not really redemption at all. I know there are pure hearts there that go to church. I saw them. They're usually in wheelchairs. At John MacArthur's church, I saw them all the pure hearts. The Lord showed me. He said 87% of the people here are fallen, but there's but it's like that's actually pretty good. So actually MacArthur had a much higher percentage. He wasn't one of them though. It was the people in the wheelchairs. And there were lots of them. They had a big area for wheelchairs. And they were all, you know, I guess not welcome in the satanic inner circles. I was told by a guy there, an elder, he said, just stay away from these people. And if you make any fuss or start talking about Satanism or the rest of the stuff you talk about, they're going to get a restraining order on you. I'm like, really? I just talk about what's in the Bible. Well, no, but there's a way to do that, Seth. That's, you know, that's not crossing a line. What line is that? Conversation over. That's what I'm talking about. That line, maybe it will always be hidden, but the children that are on the right side of it need to be honored, not hunted. Am I making myself clear? Okay. No one will ever have it quite like that. 2 hours, 13 minutes, 10 seconds, 12, 13, and shalom, shalom.